Hi, and welcome to 3dmotive.com. My name is Stephen G. Wells, and I'm a senior character artist. In this quick tips and tricks tutorial, we're going to take a look at retopologizing for animation. Right now, this is the Topogun interface. Topogun is a really outstanding retopology program. It's one I recommend to all my students. It's not very expensive, so usually can fit pretty much everybody's budget. But I'm going to go ahead and use this old model of a caricature basketball player. I've used it for other tutorials, but it just comes in handy. It's a really great model to show off for some of the stuff that we're talking about. So if I zoom in a little bit, I'm going to go ahead and turn on... I actually built this really quickly to illustrate some of the things that I see students do. Okay, and actually I see some junior modelers do this sort of thing as well. This is the main body, obviously, it's just the front and the arms, and then the face. Now, if you look at the face, if I go ahead and take off the net, per se, you can actually see, okay, this follows, if you had artwork that you were following, obviously this is following the geometry of whatever the 2D art might be. You know, you've got your polygons, you've got your edges, etc. And technically, you know, I see where somebody could build this, and I see this all the time with the students, is, you know, like, here's where the eyes are, here's where the mouth is. If you look down into the body, they don't tend to have a lot of polygons in the body, have almost none in the shoulder, like one edge loop for the elbow, and then a whole bunch of edge loops for the forearm. Never quite understood that one. But the thing is, for animation purposes, this just doesn't work. I mean, if you were to try and bend this arm forward, it would stretch all the polygons or actually make the polygons collapse on themselves. And obviously, if we were to try to make the eyes blink or the mouth move in something like this, it just isn't going to happen. I'm going to go ahead and do a quick screenshot. And in Photoshop, I've brought up the screenshot of this particular mesh. And what I want to show you, I'm going to go ahead and just create a quick layer. There we go. I'm just going to grab like a red color. The problem is here's where the eye is. Okay. And here's obviously between the lips. But there's no way that this thing can animate. It can't blink. There's no way that this has even been built so that it can absorb any of the deformations the mouth might want to do, etc. Because we're basically looking at straight up and down box modeling. That's this sort of thinking. It's, you know, here's, and we're doing this bit, you know. It's just box modeling, which of course is the basis for pretty much any model can be looked at from a box modeling standpoint. It's just basically a bunch of horizontal vertical intersections. But the thing is none of this in here would work for any of our purposes. Go ahead and just grab another color. I need to see something more like, let me go ahead and turn this off. I want to see something more like, and I'll get a nice bright color. I'll do it like a yellow, just so you guys can see this a little bit better. I tell my students, think in terms of rubber bands, okay? Rubber bands are very flexible, but of course the mainstay of rubber bands is they're circular. You know, they basically have a circular, oops, hold on, sorry about that. They basically have its circles, okay? And then once you've got the base circles, a couple of edge loops of that, you know, and you could do some in and around the mouth and here, etc. Once you've gotten that far enough, you can then start. Now, I see some people where they'll turn around and they'll extend this type of curve all the way out, and I will as well for the most part. But there will be times when I'll build out to a certain extent, and then, like, say, once I've got in this, a couple of edge loops in around here, then I actually just do connections in between, okay? It really just depends. I try to keep as many edge loops as possible, but you have to understand the cheek areas aren't what's animated on a face. The mouth is what's going to be animated, you know, the chin area, etc., depending on how stretchy or how cartoony you want the jaw to be, etc. And obviously around the eyes are going to be very animated. If you look at any of the 3D animated movies or even the 2D cartoons, The cheeks don't do a lot of movement. The foreheads don't do a lot of movement. The noses sometimes don't even do a lot of movement. But the eyes often will blink, but certainly around the mouths, there's going to be some serious deformations. Okay? Around this, let's do a quick screenshot of this. And again, you can see that, you know, in this case, it's not that they're doing anything wrong here. They're really technically not. You know, that's still enough of the cross-hatching. That wouldn't be much of a problem in the body. But there's not enough here and here, because these are the joint areas, and there's certainly not enough here. Here, in fact, we could actually lose some. We don't need this many here. I mean, this could almost be an edge loop, one edge loop starting from here, one in the middle, and then one near the end. And then make sure we've got enough here for what the wrist is going to be, like another split. But you don't need like any of these. You can just cut them down. You have to look at the idea is it's rubber bands. Where are the joints? The joints are what are important. They're the ones that need to get that elasticity. So that's where we need to make sure we have more edge loops, because that's where the model is going to bend more and it's going to look good with textures, etc., when it's animated without any stretching of the textures and certainly no collapsing of the geometry. Of course, depending on the rig, you know, that always helps. If you have a good rig, you have good edge loops, you're going to get a good model in game. So if we go back into Topogun, I would go ahead and take a look at redoing this again based on what we've just discussed. I'm going to go ahead and view our reference again. In this case, with Topogun, by the way, if you're not sure how to use Topogun, or you do know Topogun but you know, are a little unsure how to control it, it's the same sort of controls as Maya. I can left click Alt to rotate around, middle mouse Alt to pan, right mouse Alt to zoom in and zoom out. Okay, it's really that simple. The important thing is we need to look at this as, again, rubber bands. Where are the rubber bands going to be? You know, again, the mouth, around the eyes, want to make sure that's going to count. With Topogun, I'm going to go ahead and, when Topogun usually opens up, you usually have these over here. Unfortunately, I don't have enough real estate to be able to film this, etc., so I actually have to move these over a little bit. But when you open up Topogun, these will be on the same side. But I'm going to go ahead and just get into my, this is the edit tool. So this is when you want to grab your vertices, edges, or faces. Okay. This is the create tool. This is what we'll use to create our polygons with. The draw tool, we can also create polygons with, but it's a little different than just the simple create. And I tend to use just the simple create. It's quicker, it's easier, it's more direct. And this is our bridge tool, where we can turn around and just bridge the gap between polygons. And you'll see what I'm talking about in just a second. Let's go ahead, and I'm going to just grab these faces, and I'm going to hit delete. And delete. Oh, sorry. Let's go ahead and make sure we're deleting all of them. And we've got to get the edges and vertices. There we go. Okay. Oops, and we've got some here. Let's go ahead and delete those. And over here, delete. Okay. Again, like we talked about, we want to make sure that we're looking at rubber bands when we're working on this particular model. So what I would suggest you do is like start with, say, a center point on the mouth, for instance, and we're just going to create now I'm only going to do one side, because the beauty of this is we can turn around and mirror, but as you can see, I'm keeping what will be, and I'm just left clicking. Okay, if I hold my control key down, I can snap to that vertice. Here's the bridge tool. I just have to select over an edge, and you can see it wants to fill it in for me. So I'm going to do that really quickly. Oops, there we go. All right, let me just do a quick hiding on the reference. Right off the bat, you see that we're going for this flow. You see that? I'm actually going around the mouth. Okay? So we can continue something like that. By I can snap, if you hold down your control key, you're always going to snap. So I'm going to hit snap and start this off. And we'll go for another one over here. Okay. And I'm going to use my control key to snap again. We'll get to my bridge tool. Okay, let's just go ahead and select that. I can grab all of these vertices right here, and there's a button here called Zero Symmetry. If this is a symmetrical model, all I have to do is hit Zero Sim, and it'll clean it up for me right there. See that? Nice and neat. Simple. All right, let's just do quickly around the eyes, or an eye, just so you guys get the idea of where I'm going with this. I'm going to go ahead and go 3, 4. We'll just go. Again, it's just a matter of trying to stay consistent as you're working on the particular model. Keep track of how many vertices that you're creating as you're creating them. And as you can see, it almost looks like it's basically goggles, which in a way it is. We're just trying to design polygons that will encapsulate certain areas and certain parts of the model. Let's go ahead and I'm going to add in another point here. Control. Every time you're going to create something, you have to go into and out of the Create tab. So that's why I'm doing that. Okay, and I'm going to go ahead and bridge this. There we go. Now the interior, of course, you would actually grab these edges and in another program. I can't extrude these edges for this to be able to pull it in. This is a surface program, so I can't technically pull polygons in to extrude it. But again, if you know anything about modeling, you'll know you need to extrude the stuff inwards a little bit, and then you can create a sphere for the eyes. Let's go ahead and I'm going to add in a couple of polygons here. Hold my control key. Again, control and control. That snaps it. Let's go ahead and just fill that in. We can grab these here and again hit the zero symmetry. All right. So right off the bat, we go ahead and grab our vertices here. And I can now create symmetry. There we go. If I turn off our reference, okay, so see, there you go, right off the bat. That's modeling for animation purposes, because this is completely animatable. If this was textured and that mouth starts to extend and move around and the lips move, these polygons will move with it. It'll now move with the flow of the geometry rather than just geometry for the sake of it, okay? And of course, you could then build out from here, build the nose and connect all these pieces, because again, within the cheeks, you might not need to do a whole lot of the edge looping. Now, you might want to carry out some of that edge looping maybe for a little bit more if you think it's going to be a really animatable face, but I would turn around and just extend, you know, if it were me, I'd just extend some of this around as much as possible, following in, you know, the basic flow. And this is just left clicking and dragging, or left clicking on the model, and that's it. That's all I'm doing. And as you can see too, as I spread out away from the areas, away from the rubber bands, I can actually make my polygons bigger and bigger because they don't need as much deformation as up in the mouth area. Okay. So that's one of those things that you want to kind of pay attention to. Let me turn off the reference again. So you can see by the mouth and everything, it's the polygons are smaller because it's going to be more concentrated detail in that. But by the time I get to the edge of the chin, it's not so much. You can actually vary that, etc. With the arm, let me show you really quickly what I would do. I'd keep this basic. Again, this is not like it's a bad model or a bad thing when you're modeling something. But what I would suggest you do is, and you can do this in Topogun as you're building, you can double-click one edge, and it gives you the whole edge around. And just hit connect. Okay, just gave me that extra edge loop. Let's go for this, connect. Okay, so now we got our extra edge loops around our shoulders, which is good. Let's go ahead and create an extra edge loop around the elbows, or where the elbows are. Okay, and for this, let's go ahead and start taking out some of this. We don't need all of these edge loops here. I'm going to go ahead and collapse that. I'm even going to go ahead and collapse this one, and I'm going to collapse this edge. Okay, now as you can see, there is a difference between this side here, and this side there. This side works better for animation. At the joint, we've got more edge loops. At the joint, we have more edge loops. In between, not so many. You'll notice that with all these edge loops, this shape looks no different than this shape. And if it's about its silhouette, which it is in video games, you're not going to notice that this only has this few edge loops as opposed to the fact this one had like two or three times more. All right? So anyway, I hope this has been helpful. Keep in mind, again, the areas that are going to be animatable. You want to try and keep in mind to think of rubber bands. Make sure there's a number of different edge loops in there and less in between those rubber bands, and you should get a really good model out of that. I hope this has been helpful. My name is Stephen G. Wells, and this has been 3dmotive.com. Thanks for watching.